While there is currently no cure for Alzheimer's disease, there are treatments available to help slow the symptoms and slow the functional decline. The earlier the diagnosis is made and treatment is started, the more effective it will be. So ignoring symptoms or waiting until symptoms can no longer be ignored is one of the worst things that one can do. There are currently several medications available to treat Alzheimer's. These are called cognitive enhancers, and they include cholinesterase inhibitors, such as donepezil, rivastigmine, and galantamine, and NMDA antagonists, such as memantine. Cholinesterase inhibitors like donepezil, rivastigmine, or galantamine work by raising a certain chemical in your brain called acetylcholine. Acetylcholine is a chemical messenger that your brain cells use to send messages between each other. By raising this chemical, we make it easier for your brain cells to communicate with each other and therefore make it easier for you to think. NMDA antagonists like memantine work to balance out other chemicals in the brain, such as glutamate, which tends to build up in Alzheimer's disease and other types of dementias. And when it is excessive, this chemical can actually further damage brain cells through a mechanism called excitotoxicity. Despite being called cognitive enhancers, these medications can only slow the progression of cognitive and functional changes. They cannot stop the disease process, they cannot reverse symptoms or improve memory. Therefore, starting them early is vital. While what FDA-approved medications can do is quite limited, there is ongoing research at Barrow Neurological Institute and other research centers around the world on new treatments and better treatments. The hope is that these new medications will be better able to slow, stop, or even reverse the damage that occurs to the brain of individuals with Alzheimer's disease. In order to understand how these new treatments work, it is important to understand the changes that occur in the brain on a cellular level. One of the hallmarks of Alzheimer's disease is the buildup of amyloid plaque in the brain. This amyloid plaque can begin building up in the brain as early as 10 to 20 years before a person starts to show symptoms, such as memory loss. We now have specialized scans of the brain called amyloid PET scans that can actually assess whether or not this amyloid plaque is present in a person's brain. Analysis of fluid surrounding the spinal cord can also determine if amyloid is building up. Other new technologies, including blood and saliva tests, are now being developed to allow for better and earlier diagnosis as well. Now, many people have questions about what this amyloid plaque is. Amyloid plaque builds up as a result of inappropriate cutting of a certain protein in our brains. All of our brains produce something called an amyloid precursor protein. In the healthy brain, that protein is cut enzymatically in a certain way where the pieces that are left are neatly shaped, are soluble, and are easily eliminated from the brain. But for whatever reason, in individuals who are prone to Alzheimer's disease, that cutting of the protein is inappropriate. The pieces that are left are oddly shaped, they start to clump together and build up in between brain cells. What's more is they start to draw in all kinds of reactive cells that are meant to clean things up, but end up causing inflammation and further damage to the brain. This starts the brain cell damage cascade. Many treatments currently being researched in clinical trials focus on reducing the buildup of amyloid plaque in the brain, and hence interrupting the cascade of brain cell death. Some of these therapies include vaccines or antibodies which are injected or infused directly into the body and are meant to dissolve that amyloid plaque. Another change that occurs within the brain is injury of the brain cell from the inside through buildup of another pathological protein called phosphorylated tau protein. So what are tau proteins? Well, tau proteins are proteins that are actually inside our brain cell. They stabilize microtubules, which are really kind of like highways inside our brain cells. These microtubules are necessary for information and nutrients and all of the things that the brain cell needs to survive to get around that brain cell. These highways or microtubules are stabilized by pillars, much like the pillars in Los Angeles that stabilize their highways. These pillars are tau proteins. And these pillars or tau proteins start to become damaged in Alzheimer's disease. They start to crumble. And in turn, those highways start to crumble. They start to clump together and they start to form something called helical filaments. What that means is information, nutrients, everything that the brain cell needs to survive can't get around inside that brain cell. And the brain cell dies from the inside out. What's more is these pathological phosphorylated tau proteins can actually spread from brain cell to brain cell, infecting other brain cells and causing further damage. New research into ways of reducing the formation of phosphorylated tau, as well as reducing its spread from brain cell to brain cell, are being studied. These include antibodies, which are, again, injected or infused directly into the body in an effort to reduce the formation of fibrillary tangles and damage to the brain. Other treatments being tested include medications to help balance out neurochemicals, in turn reduce damage occurring in the brain, medications that improve the brain cell's lipid and energy metabolism, and even neurosurgical treatments such as deep brain stimulators, otherwise known as pacemakers for the brain. In fact, Barrow Neurological Institute was the first in the world to implant one of these pacemakers as part of a recent clinical trial in Alzheimer's disease. Some common questions that I receive from patients and families regarding clinical trials include, do I have to come off my cognitive enhancer medications to participate in a clinical trial? The answer is no. Although some clinical trials do not allow study participants to be on a certain medication, your doctor can usually find a trial that will allow you to stay on your current cognitive enhancers and do the clinical trial as an add-on. Do I have to pay to be in a clinical trial? No. For most clinical trials, there is no fee. All study visits, study medications, and study procedures are typically covered by the study. And are at no cost to the study participant. In some cases, a stipend may even be given to a study participant as a thank you for the time and effort that they are willing to make to participate in the trial. Am I guaranteed to get the active study medication? No. Unfortunately, nearly all clinical trials are placebo-controlled and double-blinded. What this means is that there is always a group of study participants that get the active medication and a group that get placebo or sugar pill. You don't know which group you're in and your doctor doesn't know which group you're in. However, many studies also have something called an open label extension phase, which follows that placebo-controlled phase. So for the first part of the study, you may get active medication or you may get a sugar pill. However, if you enter into that open label extension phase that follows, you will be guaranteed the active medication. What if I'm not interested in medications but still want to make a difference and participate in research? Well, not all research involves taking a study medication. There is still a lot that we have to learn about Alzheimer's and other types of dementias. We also need to develop better ways to more accurately diagnose these disorders. There are ongoing studies of new brain imaging techniques that do not involve medications. There are also longitudinal studies where an individual may be followed on a yearly basis over the course of their lifetime and then can opt to donate their brain after their death for autopsy and analysis. There are also studies that involve donating fluids such as saliva, blood, and even cerebrospinal fluid for analysis and development of new biomarker technologies. These can help scientists develop new therapies. All research, whether interventional or non-interventional, is extremely valuable. It is participation in this research that has brought us the medications, tests, and new technologies which we have available today. Ultimately, it is research that will bring us a cure for Alzheimer's disease and related dementias. If you are interested in learning more about participation in research at Barrow Neurological Institute, please contact 1-800-392-2222 or go to barrowneuro.org/memory.